It's not as big as me.
Different?
What? You don't want this?
This phone.
We're portraying the life of the Voyageurs as it occurred during the late 1700s and early 1800s. The people you're going to see will be people depicting the Voyageurs that paddled the 30 to 40 foot canoes that went from Montreal up to Fort Michilimackinac and even past that to the Grand Portage in Western Lake Superior. The canoes were 30 to 40 feet long and they would carry up to 4 tons of good, and there would be assigned 6 to 8 Voyageurs in each canoe. And they would often paddle from 12 to 16 hours a day, depending on the conditions. At the encampment, people would be depicting what would have occurred when a Voyageur brigade came and landed. We're at Huron Point, which traditionally has always been a landing spot and resting area for the Voyageurs, as they cut across Lake St. Clair, going from Detroit to the mouth of the St. Clair River, or vice versa. And sometimes during that time, the local residents that lived in this area along the lake, and maybe the blacksmith or some tradesmen, as well as Native Americans, would come and meet the Voyageurs and trade some of their goods for processions that the Voyageurs would need up north, like food and clothing and stuff. At the encampment, we're going to have candle making and basket making, fishnet making, as well as food demonstrations, firelock demonstrations, and demonstrations of authentic and reproduction equipment and tools that would have been used in the 1800s and early 19th century. The event will encompass both Native Americans, as well as Voyageurs, as well as locals. And throughout the grounds, people have a chance to talk to the people and learn a little bit more about the lifestyles of these people. This is an annual event. This is our second year, and in the third year we're going to have next year, hopefully by the lakeshore. This weekend I'll be making a type of fishnet that they actually use to catch the passenger pigeons. Passenger pigeons would have come by this area during the spring and fall migration. Unfortunately, they report that the passenger pigeons were so many of them that they would fill up the sky. Unfortunately, nowadays they're an extinct species, probably because of the overabundance and people didn't take care to conserve the animal, and they just kept killing it and throwing away the carcasses they didn't want. But that's a very typical thing they would have done during this time of the year. I'd also be demonstrating some fish nets that they would have made and the type of process they would have used. A lot of people make their own costumes by hand or on a sewing machine, using the style and the types of sewing methods that they would have used. Of course, people who are less inclined to sew and such can buy their outfits and their equipment from the merchants, or what we call now sutlers. They sell the stuff.
Hi, Jeff. Tell me about the blacksmith shop.
Well, blacksmiths during this time period were very important. They often repaired the musketry and the weapons used, as well as used modern day equipment for them. Today there's very few blacksmiths around, so to have a blacksmith like this, we're very fortunate. He uses traditional methods that were common back during the 18th century and early 19th century. And it's typical like this, he would have a traveling forge and he would move around the different sites. And as he pulled into the site, the people who needed their equipment repaired or perhaps needed something new made would come to him, and he would work on his shop. They would trade money if they had it, which was pretty scarce back then, or they would trade beaver furs perhaps, or farm produce as payment. And once he was done in an area, he would move on. Now there were some blacksmiths who had shops in the fort of Detroit, and they were pretty much hired out by the military and the Indian Department to take care of the military and the Indians. Of course, the local people could have used them. But out in an area like this, where it took good day travel to get to Detroit, a blacksmith traveling would be very welcome to the citizens of this area.
And he would carry all this equipment?
Yep. He would either have a boat. Yep, he would carry the forge. He would have a boat, a bateau, which is a flat-bottom boat. Or he would have a mule or a horse and have a two-wheeled cart, which are very common back then, and try to make his way down the old Indian trails. This is the encampment of the 1st Michigan Militia, Territorial Militia. It was formed during the year of 1812, at the beginning of the War of 1812, It consisted of members of the Detroit region. All males between the ages of 16 and 60 were required to enlist in the militia. It was served through this with distinction throughout the beginning of the war until it was surrendered by General Hall in the fall of 1812. Often when the voyageurs and the merchants got together, especially when there was a large crowd, the militia would have been called out to act as policemen and such. Of course, the militia took this time also to visit the different sutlers or merchants and the blacksmiths. The people often brought along their families. Sometimes the families were separated by great distances, and this offered an excellent opportunity for the women and the children to re-meet their acquaintances or family relatives. Therefore, the militia really were kind of looking forward to an opportunity like this. These are examples of sutlers that would have been common in an encampment like this. They would have left their permanent residence in the Detroit area, the immediate Detroit area, and brought their tents up to wherever the local inhabitants happened to be gathering. There they would exchange their manufactured goods, perhaps from Europe or North America, with the people for furs, fish, farm produce, and a ledger was kept. Often, people who would have excess amount of food would bring in their goods, and the merchant would give them a credit, or cash, which was referred as cash then, was something like an IOU. And then at a later date, when the merchant came back or they went down to Detroit, they would go and redeem their cash at the merchant shop. And the type of goods they would have is, of course, cloth from Europe. The English made the best type of cloth, as well as metal goods such as cans and cups and plates and silverware, maybe musket balls and flints and gunpowder, stuff that could not be manufactured out here in the wilderness of Detroit. Here's some examples of some popular trade goods with the Native Americans of the region. You can see they're made out of beads and metals. The beads were very popular because Native Americans really had no way of manufacturing such colorful beads. They often would use the inside of shells, but they had a hard time dyeing those. And when the Europeans came over, they realized that the Italians had this excellent glass bead manufacturing process down. And that quickly became one of the most popular trade items. Also, the metal, there was copper and some lead in the North America region. However, the Native Americans really did not have the technology to manufacture or to prepare that. The Europeans did, so those items made out of metals also became very popular. The traditional religious symbols were common, as well as symbols of the beaver, turtle, and river otter, which represented the natural world which the Native Americans often reflected themselves with. This is an example of the typical canoe paddled by the voyageurs. They were often made out of birch bark. The inner bark was put on the outside, which gave it the most water protection. The black lines you see was made out of pine pitch that was mixed with charcoal. And that was used to cover up the seams where the pieces of birch were sewn together, as well as to repair any rips or tears. The wooden frame is ash, and the lashing you see was made out of black spruce. An interesting anecdote about the black spruce was that the tree itself produces more root systems underground than is necessary for the tree to live with. The Native Americans often thought that the Great Spirit gave them the black spruce and the ability to get these roots without harming the tree as a means of making rope and cordage for themselves. Now, on the inside of the birch bark canoe would be small, thin slivers of red cedar planking, which added support to the canoe. These canoes were very fragile and they could tear very easily, which often resulted in the voyageurs having to go on portages. And a portage was something where they emptied out those 4 tons of goods and picked up those goods and carried them up a hill or down a hill or through a swamp area, and then they would carry the canoe. Portage was made when areas are like rapids or there's low water, and the canoe would have been damaged severely if they had gone sailing across it. The canoes also were powered by sails, which would have been put up on a breezy day like today, and it would help give a break to the voyageurs. This is a typical military tent that would have been used during the time period. Members of the militia would have been issued these. They're made out of canvas, and they were very easily broken down. course, during the military, would have slept 6 to 5 people in this tent going crosswise. Of course, at one time, there probably would have been only 4 people with different fatigue duties of the soldiers or guard duties. The tents consisted of a squad at that time, and each person in the squad was responsible for carrying the tent or the tent pole. Each squad was also given a cooking bucket or a kettle, as well as some utensils to cook with. And that was often split up among the soldiers as they marched throughout the area. The voyageurs really didn't use a tent like this, but maybe a merchant would have, to show that he could afford such much canvas as this. And this often impressed the Indians, who realized that having material things like this often raised someone's prestige in the area. This is a tarp that the voyageurs would have used. It consisted of the sail that would have been put up during the travels, and at night the voyageurs would stretch it out between the ground and the canoe like this, and then the voyageurs would all huddle up next to each other and sleep under this. It provided some comfort, and the voyageurs would often sleep on top of blankets or some furs if they had them available. This is Jebediah Smith. And Jebediah, what time period are you portraying here?
1740 to about 1840, in that era.
Uh-huh. And this is common stuff that would have been traded with the Native Americans for their fur pelts?
Most of it is, yes.
And what would have been the more popular items?
Well, trade goods, probably blankets and things of that sort, guns and things like that.
How long have you been coming to these events?
Oh, about 15 years.
And how about your wardrobe? How long has that taken you?
Oh, it's all handmade by people who are involved with encampments here. I'm a professional storyteller, so I'm a folklorist.
Okay.
And today I'll be doing some storytelling today.
Okay. Hey, Jebediah, why don't you tell us a story?
In 1863, it got so cold in Nebraska, it got to be 140 degrees below zero, which is pretty cold at that time. There was a farmer going from his barn to the house. By the time he got into the house, the flame of his lantern froze. He brought the lantern into the house, set on top of the kitchen table, and ready to go to bed, and his wife says, "You can't go to bed with a light on." He looked at that lantern and what to do with it. He couldn't blow it out, so reached inside of it and grabbed hold of the flame and covered it up in his hand and threw it out in the chicken yard. Those chickens ate those pieces of broken lantern flame. 11, 12 o'clock at night, there was so much noise out in that barnyard, everyone's chickens glowed in the dark. And 3 days later, they were laying hard-boiled eggs. That's a folk store from Nebraska.
That's terrific. One.
So tell me, what are you portraying and what do you hope to accomplish today?
Well, today I'm portraying a half-breed French and Indian, commonly known as Mati, which is means mixed blood. What I'm doing here today is I'm hoping to make some trades and trade with the Europeans and possibly get some European cloth and maybe trade some furs.
How long have you been doing this, and what got you interested in portraying this?
Actually, I've been doing this for about 10 years, and I started doing this because I got interested in shooting muzzleloaders, and the interest for that led me into a club that also did reenactment, and the next thing I know, I do more of that than I do the muzzleloading.
Do you enjoy it?
Oh, it's my main passion.
How often do you do these events, and where do you do them at?
Well, actually, right now, the ones that I do are just the ones that are local to the Metro Detroit area. Usually I can drive to them in the day and then go home at night. I used to camp with my family, but that's a lot of work. I have more fun this way.
And about how many do you do a year?
Probably 3 or 4.
And the costume is authentic, right? Everything.
Well, a lot of research and work goes into these outfits. These are center seam woodland Indian moccasins. The leggings are also center seam leggings. Would have been very commonly worn by the Ojibwe or any of the other tribes that were in the area at the time.
And the sash and all that sort of thing?
Sash is actually a European weave, which possibly would have been a trade item. The shirt is also a trade shirt, European trade shirt. The beads were also known to be trade items in the Gorges. A lot of times these were worn as trade items and would come right off to be traded for something else. Many times people would actually wear their wealth, as it was.
So what's your name?
Name is Randy Smith, and I live right here in St. Clair Shores.
Ask him if he's related to all the other Smiths that are hanging around here.
All the Smiths are related.
Did you ever go camping and need matches?
In order to make a fire a couple of centuries ago, you had to rely on other techniques than we have today. This is the flint and steel method. It's relatively easy, straightforward. You simply need to catch a spark from your steel and your flint onto your little piece of char cloth. That gives you time to transfer your little glowing coal into something called a bird's nest, which is made of natural materials that are dry, fine. And likes to burn. And we have fire.
That's incredible.
Of course, I would have a whole fire pit set up with very finely shaven wood and medium-sized wood and slightly larger pieces so that I could proceed to cook my meal.
Uh-huh.
It's quite simple. The nice thing about it is it's waterproof. Rock and steel. Doesn't matter. You can take it right out of a bucket of water and away you go. Just making sparks. From a simple, tiny spark comes your cooking fire in a matter of moments. There are other methods. On a nice day like today, you could use a burning glass, which is...
They had those in those days, the burning glass?
Well, the glass was made in Europe and then was a trade item here. There weren't factories here yet, but there certainly were people who could appreciate the power of the lens. Now, this is the wrong fiber to use. It's too white. It won't collect the heat.
Uh-huh.
I need to get out another piece of my char cloth. So down in my tin, where it's safe and dry, I always have extra char cloth ready. And I will use my fire today to make more. It's simply cloth that has been charred like charcoal.
I'll be darned.
Ouch. And now we're back in business with the coal, which gives you time. I would again have another bird's nest already made up of natural fibers, coarse, medium, and fine. I still have my fire, plenty of time. Doesn't go out quickly like a match. Fire. And I wasn't even prepared. You can use a little black powder to help your fire go if it's damp out from your musket. And there are some natural objects like a piece of fungus, which when dry has thousands of tiny little straw-like structures, very woody, so it's like a bundle of straws made of fine wood, all held together with air in between each of these tiny little holes here. And now you have your fuel, your oxygen. All you have to add is your heat, and it will burn, it will glow. I could probably get it started with a little bit of a coal here. fungus is glowing now. It's very punky and it will glow a long time so that it, again, preserves my fire, saves my effort so I don't have to start a new coal.
And do they, would they carry that around like a continuous fire?
You could kind of transport your fire. Generally, it was easier just to make a new one. As you can see, it really isn't very hard to make a new fire.
Uh-huh.
However, there were times when you wanted to carry fire from place to place. And of course, the Native Americans did not have steel originally, and so it was a little harder for them to get their spark going. And so they had other methods originally. We're talking about pre-contact with Europeans. They had really no choice but to use other natural materials. And so there were weeds basically to us that they knew how to use to create friction and therefore enough heat to get a fire started. One was the hand drill method, and the board has been prepared very carefully so that when enough heat is generated to make smoke and a coal, then the little coal would drop down through the slot here, and you could catch it on a little piece of birch bark, perhaps something that will allow you to pick it up. You can tap it free, it's still glowing, and that takes the place of your char cloth then. Now, I didn't actually get a fire started here. It takes a lot more effort than
I know. I understand
it. But that's the basic process, and then from there it's the same idea. You can take your charred little glowing coal and start all these other natural materials very easily. But it took a little more. And the Native Americans did get a little mechanical as well. I'm a little scattered yet, it's early. But basically you use a shorter piece and a cap. This would be the bow and drill method. You have a cap piece here so that you can then mechanically turn your spindle very quickly and get a lot of heat, trust me.
And a much easier way to do it too.
It is easier.
Than the other way.
There we go. I knew I had them nearby. And let's switch to a different hearth that's matched up to these pieces. So you have a little hearth board, something natural and dry, just a little piece of cottonwood from the forest right here. A prepared hole, a small spindle made from a common weed called mullein, grows in this area, and another hunk of wood with a little hole in it. And one way I keep the heat building up at the bottom more than the top is I grease the top of my spindle a little bit, make it more slippery, put a little oil on there. I already have smoke.
Yeah, I can see the smoke. There you go.
There's coffee and rolls and all sorts of goodies over behind them.
I always tucked it up there for a while. You can stick a cup of coffee in there and that's about it. Okay.
Now, had I prepared everything just so, I could easily get a coal off of this. You can see the char. And that's what would catch eventually from the heat. It's charring its own organic material, just like the char cloth had been prepared ahead of time.
I see.
And this is very, very old technology. All natural materials. Your cord, this is modern, but your cord can be made from natural materials as well for your fire kit. This one was made from a weed that grows here in the park, which many people hate. It's known as stinging nettle. But if you know how to handle it, you can get rid of the spines on the plant, crack it open, get the bark off of the plant, twist it into fiber. Much like this one that's in process right here.
So what do? Then they braid it?
It's twisted. It's a little different than braiding. It's twisted like string. If you take apart a piece of modern cotton string or twine, This is made virtually the same way, except it's done without a machine. It's done by hand. It's just a matter of getting the two strands twisted in a clockwise direction, independently, nice and tight, and eventually you can let them counter-twist together, and they don't want to come apart because of the independent twisting that's been done on each strand. Nothing much more to it than that. You can practice with string, stems of grass, any kind of a long stringy substance you can find, and doesn't really take that much to get pretty good at making this. This one's made out of the fiber from a flax plant, which we would call linen. When it's real fine and made into cloth, it would be bleached, of course, probably for fabric. I have some here made out of the bark of a cedar tree, and that would be, this is where it's been crushed up somewhat. Here's where it looks raw.
Been too busy.
That is the same as this.
The gray one right in front of you, I think, is wool.
This one's from another common weed called swamp milkweed. Grows in wet places throughout Michigan. It was a favorite by the Native Americans. Another kind of tree bark. I'm not even sure anymore which one that was. I probably just picked it up while I was hiking somewhere and started playing with it. This is the stinging nettle one. And this is more of that linen, I think, right here. The flax. Quite strong.
That's incredible.
Sizable, I think.
Absolutely incredible.
Here's another one called dogbane, which grows right here in the park. It's in the milkweed family. And a little while later, I'll be taking the raw plant and starting from scratch, making it into cord.
Now that one's not made from the bark, is it?
Yeah, it's a thin weed that grows tall, and the center is hollow, and you're getting rid of all the pith in the center and actually just using the thin bark of the common milkweed, the swamp milkweed, or the dogbane, which is in the milkweed family. Or the stinging nettle, all those are in this area here, and fairly commonly available.
So the dogbane does come from the bark then, right?
Yeah, if you can call it bark. It's so thin that you don't, it's a smooth stem, you really don't think of it as bark, but it is there. Yeah. That's about all I have at this point. That's a lot of fun.
So Jerry, can you tell us a little bit about the 1st Michigan Militia? In 1805, when Governor Hull came this way from the east, he set down the rules for our militia, which is what you see me wearing right now, the top hat with the plume, musket, blue coat knee length, a haversack, a canteen, and of course my cartridge box.
And what happened to the Michigan Militia during the war?
Unfortunately, during the War of 1812, we've seen little action in Canada. And in October, I believe it was it 19th, Hull surrendered the fort, and the 1st Michigan was disbanded for about 2 or 3 years. A lot of the soldiers, though, did, when they were paroled, they did go south and they did rejoin up with some units in Ohio or Kentucky, Tennessee.
Out of patriotism or for the money? Or what?
Patriotism. There was not much money to be made as being a militiaman, not much at all.
Do you know what they got paid?
It would depend on the state, but usually somewhere between $5 to $10 a month, plus your rations, if you were lucky enough to get any rations.
They had to feed themselves?
Quite often, if they went out on patrols, if they were gone, they would usually carry enough food for 2 to 3 days. After that, they'd have to start foraging for their own, hunting, fishing, whatever. So tell me, what's your name?
It's Jerry Bell from Trenton, Michigan.
How often do you do this throughout the year? Well, this is our first time here at this event. We do it probably six. This year is already my seventh event already this year, but that's unusual. Usually it's only about six times. These furs are common, the fur type of furs that were gathered during the Great Lakes fur trade. We have some fox here. This is a fox. This is a coyote. Here's a wolf, and I'll tell you something about the wolves in a second. Down here is a minx, and some muskrat, and some opossum, which are here also during this time period, and some deer skins. But the most valuable fur, and the reason why Detroit was founded, was because of this fur itself. This is the fur of the beaver. And if you look real close, you can see two different types of hairs. There's the long hairs that stick out here, and there's the short hairs down in here. And it's the short hairs that are oiled, which make the short hairs waterproof and make it very usable as a fur for top hats. And it was because of the top hats that's what they used. And what they would do is they'd shave off the long hairs first, then they'd shave off the short hairs. The short hairs, if you look at them, are hooks at the end. And the hooks would hook together when a guy would stand by a bench with a violin, what could be described as a violin bowstring, go back and forth and make all the hairs hook together. And that would make a felt, a typical wool felt. Then they'd go through a number of processes of shrinking the fur down, the fur felt down, and fitting it to a wood block in the form of a hat. And if you think about it, the fur time, the best time to get furs would be in the winter time, because people with dogs or cats can tell you, their animals gather more fur during the cold months, just like the beaver did. And the fur traders would tell the value of the fur by folding it in half and gently blowing on it. And then if you'd see any skin underneath, that means it was a low quality fur. You'd want to have as much fur on a pelt as possible. Now about the wolf here, there's an account in 1787 where the water table in the Detroit area was so high that the people were buried in very shallow graves. And the wolves would come in at night to the cemetery, the burial grounds, and dig up the graves and eat the flesh of the dead humans. When that happened, the wolves developed a taste for humans, and the wolves soon became a very problem. They would start attacking people. Because of that, there was a great extermination of wolves in the Detroit area in the 1790s, just out of that fear. But wolf fur was also used for fur trade. They made very nice fur collars, coats, and capes, as well as fur. The fox and the, and I don't have any rabbit, and rabbit would make very good muffs, inside the muffs. And as the beaver started to diminish very greatly, the muskrat and mink furs were used as a replacement for beaver fur. By this time, the fur trade in the area had pretty much extinguished itself and had gone further west into the Rocky Mountains.
Yeah.
Great. Do you ever wonder where all those cliches come from? Well, listen to this.
Somewhere around about $650 to $700 for a nice reproduction. And right now I'm just using my tool to tighten up a few things. And that's a tool that you would normally carry in your... But this tool is a multi-purpose. Remember the touch hole that I said is right down here in the pan? The touch hole is right here. You'd use it for cleaning the touch hole. Your flint dulls every time you use it, so you would use this part right here. It looks like a hammer. It's a little nibbing tool, and you nib off little pieces of your flint. And that's what keeps your flint sharp.
Okay.
Your flint is what actually cuts into the steel right here on this part of the musket, which is called the frism.
Okay.
And that frism, when it cuts into it, we can do a dry fire on it real quick. And now I'll bring it back to a full cock from a half cock. And if you watch, you'll see the sparks out of it.
Oh yeah.
And that's what ignites the powder that's in the pan.
Okay. What if the
now,
sparks don't hit the pan?
You have a misfire. Now what we can do is we can do what they call a flashing pan. I won't load any powder down the barrel and we'll show you what a flashing pan looks like. I just put a little bit of powder in the pan. going to stow this cartridge so we don't ignite it. And at this point, I'll point the barrel off into an appropriate area, but you can very easily see what a flash in the pan looks like.
So that's where the term comes from, right?
That's a flash in the pan. What happened in that case, if I'd been fully loaded and everything, that flash in the pan, there's a little touch hole here that touches off the powder that's in the barrel. And if that powder had not been touched off, that would have been just a flash in the pan. You've heard about a flash in the pan?
Yeah.
Have you heard about going off half-cocked?
Uh-huh.
Okay, well, right now, if you listen to the hammer as I pull it back, there's the first click. That's a half-cocked. I have to do that to move the hammer back to powder the pan. Then I have to close the frism. And now if I were to touch the trigger and it went off, that would be going off half-cocked.
Right. Oh, yeah.
So that's the term of being half-cocked.
All these terms that we've been so familiar with.
Or the term that, well, you know, where you refer to somebody that, you know, it was just a flash in the pan. Well, you know, you were ready to fire and all the excitement. That's the term flash in the pan. He lost it all. What do they say when they lost it all? Lock, stock, and barrel. Okay. Where's the lock? The lock is right here. This is the whole lock assembly, the mechanical mechanism that drives that hammer forward, which hits the frism, which makes the spark, which sets off the powder in the pan. Stock right here. That's the wood piece going all the way across on it. And then you have your barrel. So if you lost it, if you lost it all, but you have to remember in this time period, this was a very valuable tool to have. And it was referred to as a tool more than anything. I can shoot with this particular musket. It's a French-made musket, and you can see it's a sizable bore. And black powder is very nasty. You can see the dirt on my fingers from firing it once today. That was a clean barrel this morning. And this particular musket, they used to fire what they called buck and ball. They would put a 69 caliber ball down there, which I do happen to have one of those. I'll get you to hold on to this tray for me. This is a 69 caliber ball, and it's a good sized ball. You can see that you wouldn't want to be hit with that. They would put the ball down there, and in that cartridge, they would already have buck on it, which would be three 30 caliber balls, roughly in that size category, and they would put those on top of it. So this would go down there, and they would shoot. There's the ball, and the 330 calibers would have been buck. But since this is a smooth bore, I can also put shot down this barrel and fire it like I would bird shot.
Okay.
Compared to, you know, a standard rifle, where a rifle, as far as the groups were concerned with the rifle, you could only load a rifle maybe once a minute because you had the rifling, the lands and the grooves. That's where you get the twist that makes the ball spin when it comes out. It's harder to load one because the ball wants to turn as it goes down. So you're constantly ramming several times to get it down to the bottom of the barrel. Where with a smooth bore, your ram is usually just a straight shot down because the ball does not have to turn. And you might have to hit it two or three times, come all the way down to the barrel. And you want to fully seat your ball because it'll blow up in your face otherwise. Then you'd have to come around and stow your rod again. Now we can, for demonstration purposes, we can go ahead and fire one more and I'll utilize that cartridge that I hadn't finished. You can find it. So we're already at half cock. I've opened up the pan. I am now going to powder the pan. Close the pan, come about, the powder would go down, and you notice we don't use a powder horn. That's a very bad move to use a powder horn for loading a weapon, just due to the fact that if I had a full horn full of powder like this, if I happened to touch that off, because of the last round that I'd fired, this would blow up. This would be like a stick of dynamite going off in your face.
So that's only used to fill the...
That's only a storage compartment.
Yeah,
you don't want to load from the horn. Usually you use pre-measured cartridges. Now at the bottom of this cartridge would have a ball and a patch, and I would have to more or less that kind of make it look like a ball seated like this. Get it started, pull the ramrod, shove it down the barrel, and since there's live powder, I'm not going down the barrel with it. Stow the rod, that's ready. Now, if you heard it click, that was coming back to a full cock. My next order would be probably to take aim. So at that point, I'll find a good place to aim. I take aim, and then I'd be told to
fire.